This episode is brought to you by CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service that offers over 2,000 documentaries and non-fiction titles. Unlimited access starting at just $2.99 a month and 30 days for free if you sign up through the link below and use the code BRAINFOOD. More on them in a bit. And in the video today, we're answering a viewer question because Joseph Bennett asks us, what happens to the bodies if a cryogenic company goes bankrupt? Well, the easy answer to that is, where do you think the meatballs in IKEA come from? And I really hope you enjoyed that video, if you did not really. On the whole, even some of the largest and most successful companies in the world eventually fail, with companies offering their services to make you a popsicle after your body decides to say screw you, in particular, being no exception. So what happens to the approximately 350 people, and rising fast, who are stored this way when a cryonic company goes the way of their customers? Is it really only 350 people? I thought it'd be way higher. There's got to be tons of rich people who want to be frozen. Well, for starters, it turns out that thanks to the fact that every single one of the earliest cryonic companies went belly up, the latest generation of cryonics companies have put in place some nearly surefire ways to keep that from ever happening to them, outside of, you know, stuff like a World War III nuclear holocaust or stuff like that. But as to the early cryonics companies, these were first started in the 1960s and initially just advertised as freezing bodies for cosmetic reasons, rather than the literal hope of reanimation. It's like, great, so my family can look at my dead body? And in fact, early efforts here didn't even bother to try and stop damage to tissues from ice formation in the freezing process. They simply froze the bodies directly. Patient Zero, the first guy frozen using a method meant to preserve him in the hope of future reanimation, however, had a basic cocktail of preservatives and chemicals meant to stop such ice crystal formation, with this man being former psychology professor Dr. James Bedford, who died of cancer in 1967. As to what happens with these early companies, the big issue, beyond equipment failures and faulty procedures resulting in accidental thawing, was that they relied on friends and family of the deceased to make regular payments to keep the bodies nice and frozen. Should the deceased's loved ones just decide that they didn't want to pay these anymore, which almost universally happens after their death, their mostly dead loved ones would be allowed to, well, thaw out and complete the dying process. Although, interestingly, in at least one company's case, they were found in 1979 to have thawed, some intentionally, others accidentally, 17 of the 18 bodies that they were storing without notifying anyone. Naturally, lawsuits ensued, but big surprise, the company was bankrupt. In other cases, once the bodies were accidentally thawed or the payments had just stopped, the companies simply notified the deceased next of kin and popped the body in the post. Not really, I'm assuming there was some sort of collection process. That said, the one and only patient to survive these early efforts, funnily enough, was patient zero, James Bedford. His still frozen body was transferred to his son when the company storing him went under. His son then dutifully took steps to keep Bedford frozen for many years before handing the body over to Alcor, a more modern cryonics company. Noteworthy here was that when his body was transferred to their facility, Alcor representatives noted upon inspecting Bedford that his body was actually in excellent condition, at least externally. So, moving on to those more modern companies, should they fail, as they are technically not guaranteeing to eventually see the body stored at their facilities reanimated, presumably the same thing that happened with the first generation batch of companies will happen. The bodies will be transferred over to the relatives of the deceased for them to do whatever they please with. That said, learning from the failures of their predecessors, as alluded to, these companies are generally set up a little bit differently in terms of ensuring their long-term viability. Apparently, no one can trust their family to keep paying to keep them frozen. On top of that, the two biggest companies are set up as non-profits as well. As for how they keep themselves funded, first, rather than relying on loved ones, payments, usually via a life insurance policy or portion of one's estate, must be bequeathed to them, unless of course you die in such a way that they can't preserve you or they can't do it fast enough. I'm imagining some sort of horrific car crash. The cost of such storage ranges from about $28,000 to $200,000, depending on the package chosen and the company, with the only companies in existence doing this being the United States and Russia. And I believe they're at the lower end of the spectrum, I'm not sure, but I think it's just because they're freezing your brain. They take your brain out and just freeze that. I might have looked into this at one point. Beyond that, they require a sort of annual fee before you die. For example, Alcor requires $700 per year, and the Cryonics Institute requires $120 annually, or a one-time payment of $1,250. For reference here, it only costs about $150 to $800 per year to maintain a body and the facilities for it. Thus, at least strictly when talking facilities and storage, so long as the companies have more people alive waiting to be frozen than are currently stored, there will always be at least a base level of money needed to maintain the facilities, which don't really require many people to keep going at all. Also, for reference, Alcor reports over 1,200 people on the waiting list to be stored, versus only a little over 170 currently stored, and CI has over 2,000 on their waiting list, versus about 160 currently stored. These numbers are also rising dramatically every year from the year before. While those annual fees do provide some steady cash flow for the companies, the more viable long-term plan comes in the form of a trust that, for example, Alcor requires be set up, with, in their case, the amount per person ranging from $25,000 to $110,000 depending on the storage type. This is included as a part of the aforementioned cost of being stored. Currently, Alcor's public filings show that they have a bit over $10 million in their trust fund. As to why this can potentially be a bulletproof plan, Ben Franklin aptly demonstrated this when he left £1,000 to each of the cities of Philadelphia and Boston, £146,000 or $167,000 today when adjusting for inflation. The catch was that they couldn't have the money until 100 years after his death, with the money to be held in a trust. Further, after that 100 years, the cities could only take a portion of it out and had to leave the rest for another 100 years. And look, if you've got any idea how compound interest works, this is going to be pretty great. But how did it actually work out? After one civil war, several major stock market crashes, a slew of pandemics, and two world wars, among others, in 1990, when Philadelphia cashed out their second installment, it was worth a whopping $2 million. That's £1.7 million. Boston, on the other hand, which had opted to leave more of a fund in after the first withdrawal, had about $5 million, £4.4 million, at their disposal that year. The power of compound interest, even when there's wars and catastrophes and stuff like that, is still pretty incredible. Don't forget it. Okay, so let's go back to the cryonics companies. To further make sure that the investment boards are wisely investing these trusts, it is required, for example, at Alcor, that a large percentage of the board have loved ones currently at the facility awaiting medical science to go full Star Trek the Next Generation, the neutral zone on them, and or themselves be slated to be frozen when their bodies cease to keep on keeping on. Interestingly, if a person is eventually revived, the remainder of their percentage of the trust at that point will apparently be transferred back to the person to help them get started in the no doubt strange new world that they find themselves in. And that just really makes me think that if I was going to get frozen, I would put a lot of money in their trust so that when I woke up, I'd be extremely rich. Of course, this could potentially be catastrophic for the companies if everyone is revived at once, but given at that time, as reanimation would now be by definition fully possible, the viability of the company after this, one way or another, isn't really a concern. Now, just before we continue with today's video, let me thank our sponsor, CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is a subscription streaming service that offers over 2,000 documentaries and non-fiction titles from some of the world's best filmmakers, including exclusive originals. Now, if you're enjoying this one, then why not try out CuriosityStream for free and check out their docuseries called Waiting for Immortality, which looks at cryogenics as a way to extend life, but also at a whole lot of other ways that people are essentially trying to live forever. Now, a bit of a disclaimer, I have not actually seen this documentary yet. I just had a look at it right now, skipped through it, and yeah, basically I know what I'll be watching tonight. It looks awesome. It's available on many platforms: web app, Roku, Android, Xbox One, smart TVs, iOS, Chromecast, Amazon Fire, Amazon Kindle, Apple TV. So, like, everything. Get unlimited access starting at just $2.99 a month, and for you guys, the first 30 days are completely free if you sign up at curiositystream.com/brainfood and use the promo code brainfood during the sign up process. Link below. It's a great way to support the show. And let's get back to it. This all brings us to the likelihood of reanimation given modern methods. To begin with, this in part depends on how quickly you can be frozen. To help ensure things are handled in a timely manner, beyond approximate known death times, as in the case of late-stage cancer patients, making sure representatives from the companies are on hand to do their thing as soon as legally allowed, usually a couple of minutes after death is declared, the companies also give out bracelets and necklaces for subscribers to wear so that those who find their body know immediately to contact the cryonic company. They also advise you to tell your loved ones your wishes. Although, given the amount of money being transferred to these companies upon death, let's just say living relatives don't exactly always have the best track record of making sure that these companies are notified quickly in some cases. People's families suck. It's like, yeah, no, we let the body go a bit funky and I guess he can't be frozen now, so we'll take all the money. From there, the modern methods of freezing and proprietary cocktails of chemicals have improved markedly from the early efforts. For example, in 2016, researchers at 21st Century Medicine managed to successfully use a cocktail of vitrification solution of their own making to lower the temperature of a rabbit and a pig brain to minus 135 degrees Celsius, that's minus 211 degrees Fahrenheit. They then later slowly warmed the brains back up, flushed the chemicals out, and analyzed them for damage. The results? Well, they'd successfully kept the cell membranes, intracellular structures, and synapses seemingly intact. To quote the paper on the subject, preservation was uniformly excellent. Processes were easily traceable, and synapses were crisp in both species. That's incredible. All that said, given the toxicity level of the cocktails being used here and dehydration damage to cells and the like during the processes involved, many medical professionals think even if the tissues and neurons are all extremely well preserved overall, the damage from all of this is enough that even if the chemicals are all flushed out upon revival and blood being reintroduced, this will still result in the impossibility of full reanimation of the tissues. Excellent condition is of course not perfect condition, oh dear. That said, even if the tissue itself can't be reanimated, some speculate it's always possible if well preserved enough. Technology may either be able to repair the damage or someday allow for mapping the neurons and connections and the like, and then transferring that to a computer system, allowing your consciousness of a sort, or at least the memories, to potentially live on in a cybernetic form. So essentially we're talking about putting your brain in a robot. That is epic. Further advancements in cryonic technology are also looked at in the form of not necessarily freezing people at all, instead simply removing the brain and keeping it alive in an unconscious state. That sounds horrific. While that may sound like complete science fiction, it turns out that researchers at Yale have already managed it, albeit only for a short time. In this case, they took over 100 pig brains and hooked them up to a system of pumps that circulated warmed artificial blood to provide oxygen and nutrients. With their method, they were able to successfully keep the brains alive and functioning normally for 36 hours. At the end, the brains were analyzed and found to be, by all appearances, in great condition. Now look, I'm not a member of like PETA or anything, but that sounds pretty horrific. Those brains were probably conscious. If one could eventually advance that technology for indefinite storage, there's potential to keep the brain alive and perfectly functional until head transplant technology is perfected. And while that also seems like something needing many decades of advancements, it turns out that that too actually isn't as futuristic as you might think. For example, one Dr. Ren Xiaoping and his team in China have successfully transplanted literal heads of hundreds of rats and other animals onto new host bodies, including transplanting monkey heads. For the curious, Dr. Xiaoping reports that a monkey head transplant takes approximately 20 hours to complete, and he expects a human head transplant to take an additional 10 to 20 hours on top of that once they reach a suitable success rate on monkeys, which are very similar to humans, of course. Should these two methods of keeping a brain alive outside a body and eventual transplant be perfected, people using this method of preservation may have a much sooner fix than reviving cryonically frozen individuals. Although one can only imagine the living nightmare if the brain remains conscious during such a stasis, no longer being hooked up to any sensory inputs or means of output at all, and simply existing for years in that state. Needless to say, should that occur, one would assume nearly everyone would have gone fully mad by the time of any revival in a new body. Although it should be noted here that researchers in the pig brain study note, given the brain activity at the time, they are reasonably sure the pig brains weren't conscious, for whatever that's worth. I think it's worth a lot, actually. All this said, seemingly everyone, including the cryonics companies themselves, concede the likelihood of eventual reanimation is low, with the mantra within the industry that being cryonically frozen is the second worst thing that can happen to you. But given the odds of reanimation are definitely zero if you're buried or cremated, and given that you can't take your money with you after you're gone, more and more people are taking a flyer on this particular lottery ticket. This is especially true as all it takes to enter the game is having a reasonable estate upon your death or a decent life insurance policy. Although if you were ever revived, that begs the question, would you have to pay back that life insurance policy? If you're wondering, we have a likely answer to this question in our video, do you get your stuff back if you go missing or are declared dead, then turn up alive like a certain Shire Hobbit? That video is going to be linked to below, but in the end, should the cryonics process fail, which is probably likely, well, you were dead anyway, so, you know, may as well. But then again, if it succeeds, well, you get to find yourself far in the future with wonderful technology and everyone you know and loved having long ago died, and there's probably robot overlords who make you a slave. Yay! So I really hope you liked that video. If you did, smash that like button below. Don't forget to subscribe. Brand new videos just like this every day of the week. For more from me, why not check out another channel I do called Business Blaze? It's linked to below, and thank you for watching.